Good evening.
George is nothing like the monster he portrays on television. Like me.
By the way, I'm Doug.
Absolutely no baked potatoes before 5 p.m. It's prime time with George Nerunda. Tonight, head coach of the Sacramento Kings, Gary St. Jean, EFO, the Eddie Foreman Orchestra, plus the Entertainers. So get ready for the most entertaining show on television.
Hi, I'm George Nerunda, and welcome to Primetime. And you know, we just got this late breaking news bulletin. You know, they had a report that at their peak in the Gulf War, Iraq had the capability to produce 4 bombs a year. Well, that's nothing. Hey, here at Primetime, we can produce 4 bombs a year. And hey, what a great show we have for you. And let's just get the show underway. It's me and my very own entertainers performing Wookin' for Wove. Yes, the Entertainers and Wookin' for Wove. And what was wrong with Doug earlier? And What was that thing he had on his head? Hey, I don't know if you could ask for much more entertainment than we have for you right here tonight on free television, but there's more where that came from. And when we return, it's the Sacramento Kings head coach, Gary St. Jean.
This blue represents pride and determination. The red, the courage and sacrifice shown by those few who knew what it was to stand alone. The white, honor and integrity. The same could be said for this red, white and blue. Is it any wonder so few can wear it?
My next guest has had a formidable coaching career in the NBA and is now the new head coach of the Sacramento Kings. It's a pleasure to welcome back to primetime basketball coach personified, Gary St. Jean. Well, Gary, welcome back to primetime. It's a pleasure to be here again, relaxing lakeside at Cape Cod at the summer mansion of Gary St. Jean.
I don't know if it'd go to that extent, but it's great to see you again, George, and it's great to be talking to the people back in Chicopee.
Well, a lot has happened in the last year, or actually 2 years since the last interview. You were actually on the second show. You preceded Killer Kowalski.
What an honor.
And it's an honor again.
Yeah, we're really excited about what's happened with our lives and really looking forward to this coming NBA season, the challenge of becoming a head coach in the NBA, and our family's very excited about it. And it's just been terrific hearing from so many friends back in Western Mass and my family. And to be truthful and honest with you, I was very happy with what I was doing before. And I think family and friends are more excited about this opportunity than really I am.
Well, are you finding that it's a lot more work now being the man on top?
No, not really. It's just you have more decision making, but probably the most change that you have to make is the demands from the media, talking to the papers and the radio and the TV all over the country. It's much more time consuming that way. You're more of a behind the scenes guy on as an assistant coach, and when you become the head guy, then maybe a few more people want to talk to you.
You become the spokesperson.
Yeah, by and large, that's what it is.
And when you're winning, you're a hero. And we won't even talk about that, right? We're going to have a perfect season.
The greatness of this is that we're still undefeated at this point. We're very excited about that, and that's what I tell everybody. And we're just thrilled that this is going to take place. And to be honest with you, it's there's pressure involved, but it's pressure that I've wanted, and I really, really am excited about the challenge of doing this. I haven't been a head coach since my days at Chicopee High School. It's been 12 years as an assistant, and we've had a very successful summer camp out in Sacramento and then in Salt Lake. Got to work with our first round pick there, and of course I've had great years the past 4 years with the Warriors, and I've been with Don Nelson 10 out of my 12 years, and so I feel like my time has come, and I'm ready for it and really excited about the challenge.
You got to test your strategies.
Well, it's true, and George, the best thing I can say about my years with Nelly was that I'm going to really utilize everything that we did with Golden State, because there isn't any copyright in Washington, D.C. about our offensive and defensive scheme, so we will be very patterned after the Warriors. We'll be an up-tempo team trying to run a great deal, and it's an exciting brand of basketball that is the game of the 90s. The players enjoy playing it, mm-hmm. The fans enjoy watching it, and we feel it's going to be a very exciting to be involved with, and we feel good about our prospects for the future.
Well, speaking of Don Nelson, now when you go back to play against Golden State, having worked with him for 10 out of 12 years, is it?
Yeah.
Is that going to change your strategy? Are you going to use some of his own strategies against him? Or do you have any secrets of his?
Well, I'm blessed that I believe that I've gone through all the eras that he's coached in and all the changes that he's made and the positive things that have happened in his career I've been lucky to be a part of. And there won't be anything that he's going to pull on us that it's going to be new as far as our staff, because my two assistants both coached with me in Milwaukee, as well as one of them in Golden State. So we'll be doing some camouflaging with our signals on our plays to each other, but strategically, I don't think we're going to be able to pull the wool over each other's eyes. So that's a positive. And as you know, we will play them our very first exhibition game in October at Golden State. So I'm sure it being an exhibition game, there might be a prank or two pulled on each other. But hey, I'm going to be very proud to be sitting there as a head coach, because the ultimate compliment I can pay him is to become a head coach and to utilize what he's given me over my career. It was a fabulous year last year, George, in the sense that we won 55 games at the All-Star break. We had the top record in the league. We coached in the at the All-Star game in Orlando. Nelly and our staff was awarded the Coach of the Year award for the third time, and I was fortunate to be the only one that he's had as an assistant that's been involved with all three staffs that have achieved that award. So it was an extremely special year for our entire staff and team, and I'm really going to miss the Warriors and their people.
Now, what was it like coaching at the All-Star game?
Well,
was that the highest level of excitement?
It's one of the top days in my basketball career. It was very special for me because I was able to bring our daughter Emily along, and my wife was there, Mary Jane, and my mom, Jesse, flew down from Chicopee, and we flew my wife's mom down from Concord, and it was in Orlando, and you know, Magic Johnson, with the HIV virus, contacted in the middle of the year, contracted. Him playing in this game was very special, and it was talked that this might be his last NBA performance. And just going to the practices and being around these players and the quality of the people and the media coverage and just so many great memories for myself and my family, things we'll never forget and we cherish very much. Like Magic Johnson was so nice to my daughter. You know, he gave her a big hug and he signed all his, her book, you know, and all this kind of thing. And we're at the end of the game, we're winning by 40. So he sees me waving up to my wife and my daughter and my mom. He says, "Coach, what are you doing?" I said, "I'm waving to my daughter, Emily." "Oh, I'll wave to her too," he says. So there we are, two nuts on NBC waving up to the kids.
On national television.
Yeah, what the heck? It was great. That was really a great weekend. Big stars, it was neat.
So you worked with all of the best in one
day. Yeah, that was really a neat thing. You know, Michael Jordan's there, Magic's there, you know, Chris Mullin from Timmy Hardaway from our own team, and yeah, it was really, really neat. Special, special, special day. Real neat.
So what changes do you plan on making as a head coach? Do you feel you have any new insight, any new secrets, any new tricks of the trade that you've developed on your own?
What you must watch out for becoming a rookie head coach is try to implement too much stuff. You have to teach the fundamentals. It isn't any different than when I was at Chicopee High School. And one of the qualities that I believe that I can bring to the Sacramento Kings is a positive, upbeat attitude. This team has been down, and there's new ownership there. And through the interview process, which was minimum four-hour sessions with the new ownership, that was what I tried to convey to them, that we're going to teach the game the right way and we're going to be upbeat about it. And if anything, just go at the game and keep it simple, but not let anybody outwork us. Be prepared to play every day. We're really looking forward to training camp in the beginning of October, and you know, we're crossing the days off. It's going to be really exciting for us.
So you're looking forward to that dynamite season. Do you think you're in line for the championships, for the playoffs?
You know, George, it's a good question. What do you set for goals when you go in as a rookie head coach? We're a team that's going to strive for the bottom spot in the playoffs. In the Western Conference, which is loaded with great teams, with Portland and Phoenix and Utah and Golden State and a number of other quality teams, our goal will be to get to the bottom of the playoffs, which would be a team that comes somewhere around 500. And that's an optimistic goal. If we can just show improvement, winning 5 to 6 more ball games, I think that will be a good accomplishment for this upcoming season. And then what we'll try and do is to acquire another quality player in the draft, and then you develop a nucleus And as you build your nucleus and they believe in your system, you begin to put it together and become a consistent playoff team that then, over the years, becomes a contender for a world championship. But you have to climb the ladder step by step. And, you know, all my friends from Chicopee have asked me that. And, you know, I'm really excited. Some of them might even come out for the opening night. And, you know, my mom will be out there, if not opening night, then during the season, as well as my other family members. And it'll be a real thrill coming back into Boston again as a head coach, too.
Well, I know we can't forget the people back in Chicopee. You had some phone calls. I know as soon as you leave off a couple of names or something and the phone calls start coming in, and you really didn't. I mean, because of the length of the segment last time, the editing machine. We had to edit some of the things out, but let's give you some time now to speak to your friends back in Chicopee.
Well, George, it's always special to talk with someone from back home, and I feel like an ambassador from Chicopee because I'm always promoting where I came from. I'd move back there tomorrow. Why I would move back there is the quality of the people. And it focuses around my family. My mom still lives in Chicopee Falls, and two of my brothers are there, and my sister's up in Covington, and they're very special to me. And I've got some very, very special friends. Probably my closest friends in my life are the guys back there that I have had a long, long relationship, and then there's all the people that I was involved with coaching and then teaching over the years, you being one of my former students. I think if you were to take your hat off, we'd really see what you've grown to be. It's really very special to me, and as I talked to you on the phone after I got the job, I've had well over 100 phone calls and hundreds of cards and letters, and talked to the writers back home, and that was a really heartwarming thrill for myself. And one of the sad things for me is I don't get to spend as much time as I like to up there. I do get to see my close friends and family down here on the Cape, but going along with the head coaching territory probably means even less time here than what I used to have.
Well, you could barely scrape by a few weeks in the summer, and now it's really difficult to get in touch with you.
Well,
you're traveling on a daily basis.
It's difficult, but again, I think you must understand where you came from and be very proud of the fact of what you're doing and never knock the travel and the time requirements in the job, because I'm a lucky person. I'm doing something that I absolutely love. I fulfilled all my dreams in life in terms of jobs, so I never put down the travel and the time requirements of the job because, again, as I said, I'm doing something I love, and it's going to be in a very exciting time in our lives.
Well, is this the ultimate? Where can you go from here?
Well, the only thing to do now is to create a winning team in the NBA, and I guess that the true test of a successful NBA coach is longevity. Once you become an NBA coach, the true signal of an NBA coach is when you do get fired, because this job profession is more risky than a Fortune 500 job. The CEO turnover rate is far less than the NBA coaching rate of longevity. So I understand the riskiness or the what's involved with it, and hey, I'm really excited about the challenge.
And you're here to build that unstoppable megaforce.
Well, that's what we're going to try and do, and I'm just trying to rejuvenate my juices right now, spending some quality time with my family, getting some rest, and you know, that's one of the downsides of the job is the time that you do travel, you're not with your family maybe as much as you'd like to be. So I try to spend as much time as I can with Mary Jane and Gregory and Emily, and of course to get my mom and family down here as well.
Well, Gary, once again, always a pleasure, and I'll look forward to seeing you in the championship series.
Well, I hope that's not too far off, George. And let me say that you're the first guy from Chicopee that's got to wear a Sacramento Kings hat. I'm very proud of that and very proud of you and the accomplishments you've made in the television area.
Hey, we try to entertain. I try to be the most entertaining person in the world, right? Have I succeeded?
Absolutely, and I remember when at Chicopee High School.
Back in the good old days.
The good old days.
Once again, it's a pleasure, and we'll look forward to seeing you at Boston Garden. Stick around. We'll be back with more of the big program right after this.
It's one of those days when everything goes wrong. It starts off bad and gets worse all day long. It's one of those days when you catch the blame for things you didn't do. It's one of those days when you need a friend to pull you through. Bad days need good friends like you.
Adopt your own good friend today.
You know, a while back we had our staff talent night and Jeff Janik did his little basketball demonstration, and we did have a few cards and letters. There were a few discrepancies. So while we had Coach Gary St. Jean with us, we thought we'd roll the tape, let him take a look at it, and get his professional analysis.
Well, Coach, what do you think?
Well, after evaluating this tape on Mr. Jeff Janik, he is unequivocally the worst basketball player I have ever seen. First, you show me him shooting air balls. Then you show me him trying to dunk on a 2-foot, 1-inch hoop, and he fails at that. He better find another profession in life. It is not basketball.
Well, as usual, I was right. Jeff should stick to hockey.
Boy, that smog outside is terrible.
Don't you just hate what they're doing to the environment?
They? What about you?
Moi?
Sure, lots of household products can cause pollution, especially if we don't use them in the right way. To find out how you can help, write to Make a Difference, National Wildlife Federation, Washington, D.C., 20036.
I just love it when you talk environmental.
Yes, this next group will be making their fifth appearance on the program. Yeah, well, I don't know. Our records here show five, and I'd like to see them back in 6 months for a cleaning. Yes, here is EFO performing What a Wonderful World.
We'd like to bring you back to an earlier day when a young musician from Chicago was revolutionizing the field of jazz. His name was Louis Armstrong. At this time, we'd like to recreate the spirit of that great musician as Steve Duda sings one of Satchmo's greatest hits, What a Wonderful World.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, bright, blessed day, the dark, sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry, and I watch them grow. They learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. wonderful world.
Hey, how about that? They intro their own songs and everything. They don't even need me. And Doug, where have you been all day? What, have you just been vegging out?
Yeah, I've been here lounging around in the cool chairs.
And what's that thing you have on your head?
Oh, it's a mumbo sock.
A mumbo sock?
Mumbo sock. Well, sock for your head.
Hey, we'd like to thank the folks here at Epstein's for letting us come in and play with their electric furniture. You push the button and it pops up. And then we have our snacks down here. Let's see, we have our sodas here. And we pop this down.
George and his snacks.
And yes, more food. And where are the chips, Doug? Trying to hide them on me. Confiscating the chips. Hey, we've had too much fun here. Join us next time. Good night, everyone.
Wildlife rabies is now a threat in Massachusetts. Avoid contact with wild animals. Let wild things be wild. Pets can also become infected and bring this deadly disease into your home. By vaccinating your cats and dogs, you protect yourself and your family. Vaccinations against rabies are available through your veterinarian. For more information on rabies, contact your local health department or veterinarian. Rabies is a risk no one needs to take.